Welcome for the lecture of System Programming. Today, we will be discussing regarding details of working of macroprocessor. So for that, I will let you know the parameters or the set of keywords which are reserved for macro expansion. In last unit, we have discussed regarding how assembler works and all, which instructions that it supports, which types of instruction it has. On the similar lines, this is also one of the facility which is provided to be used in assembly program. So macro is one of the utility which you can use while writing assembly code. Then we need to understand exactly how once whenever you are using this utility named as macro in an assembly program, then how assembler deals with it. All right. So what is the scenario? There are two scenarios. Either you can think of modifying or giving the capability to your assembler so that it will be able to handle definitions of macro written in it, or you can have separate utility, separate logical unit for the sake of handling these macro definitions. So this is what is the way things are or the brief broad picture of macro, use of macro in an assembler. Now we need to understand exactly which are the various keywords which are used in macro, how it is defined and how it looks like, and which are the directives which are used in macro, which are other instructions which are supported in macro and all. Basically, first of all, before moving to all that syntactical details, we need to first of all understand what is the purpose of using macro in assembly program? Exactly for what purpose this particular utility is made for? You know? So the reason behind that is macro is the, you can make use of macro in an assembly program when certain set of instructions are required to be used repeatedly in the assembly program. In that case, macro is, one can think of using macro. Okay, so that you will not have to define that set of instructions everywhere repeatedly. So what can be done? So the way which is given, once you are aware of the set of instructions which are required to be used repeatedly, you can define that set of instruction under macro, macro definition you can call that. And wherever that set of instruction is required in an assembly program, there you need to call the macro. Whatever name you would be giving to that set of instruction, that is called as name of the macro, you need to call that macro. And the way this is dealt by assembler is, wherever the call to the macro it is going to get, at that time it has to perform the task of expansion of macro. That is called as macro expansion. So wherever it is called, all the set of instruction which belongs to the definition will get substituted over there. This is how macro, this is how the thing, you can call the way macro is defined and utilized in the assembly program. So we'll go now syntactically how exactly macro looks like and which are the various statements supported in it. So basically, I have already told you, if assembler, you are going to give capability to the assembler for handling macro, then it is called as macro assembler. Otherwise, the logical unit, if it is just designed for the sake of handling of macro, it is called as macro preprocessor or macro processor. So that macro preprocessor comes in advance, or macro processor has to come in advance before starting working of assembler. It has to deal with the macro. It has to get the whatever processing is to be done with respect to the macro, whichever are defined in the program. And then it further carries out the task of assembling all the instructions for the sake of conversion into machine code. So the thing over here which you need to understand is the way functions are defined generally in programming language on the same line at macro is required to be defined, and that definition is called as macro prototype, which declares the name of the macro and the name of kinds of its whichever formal parameter you would like to pass while calling the definition of the macro. Then whatever statements are there in the definition of macro are termed as model statements. And whenever you call macro, at that time, it has to substitute, or assembler or microprocessor has to substitute that model statement at its place. Okay. So that is what is given over here. Formal definition, you need to first of all declare the prototype. This is how the prototype will get declared. Name of the macro and list of formal parameters you need to specify in front of it. And the parameters can be passed. Whichever parameters are to be passed are to be listed as a list of formal parameter. It that is specified by this particular operator. Ampersand is required to be prefixed before the name of every parameter name. There are two types of parameter in the macro, namely or categorically you can call that as a positional parameter and keyword parameter. So how that differs is nothing but from the point of view of the way that two parameters are handled by the macroprocessor. That is the difference over there. If let's say positional parameters are used while defining the macro, in that case, whenever that macro is called, the way sequence is written in the declaration statement, in the same sequence equate operation will get assigned. So what exactly happens is whenever you call the macro at that time, whatever actual parameter list you would be specifying over there, that gets assigned to the formal parameter, list of formal parameters. Now, so if you are using all the parameters as a positional parameter, let's say four positional parameters you have used for defining the macro, in that case you need to specify four actual values while calling that macro definition, and sequentially the sequence in which that are given while calling it actually, in that same sequence it will get assigned to the formal parameter list which you have declared while defining the macro. And another parameter type of macro is keyword based parameter. So what exactly is that keyword based parameter and how it is denoted is nothing but this is how the keyword based parameters, these are whatever is written over here, all are positional parameters, and for every parameters or variables whichever you are using in the macro, all are written by using ampersand as a prefix over there. And now I'll be telling you regarding keyword based parameter. So whenever you are using or you want to use keyword based parameter, at the time you need to make use of this over here, so which indicates equal to at the end of name of the variable, which indicates it is keyword based parameter. So what is the difference over here? Whenever you are using keyword based parameter, so if you are using this equal to at the end of name of the variable or value of the name of the parameter, it indicates this is keyword based parameter. So what the flexibility or exactly what difference it gives is nothing but whenever keyword based parameters are used while calling the definition of the macro, these sequence of the variables can be changed. But how it can be changed, it does not perform the assignment operation as per the order of the variables. Instead of that, what it does while calling that parameters, actually you need to explicitly mention the name of this keyword based parameter and then equal to whatever value you want to assign to that. For example, over here, this is a given thing. This is the macro call given for keyword based parameter. So if we'll go through this definition, what it is. In this definition, these are the positional parameters. Mixed type of parameters can be used while declaring macro. So these two are positional parameters and these two are keyword based parameters. So from what you can identify, this equal to is used over there. But here what extra difference is there? Here this keyword parameter is initialized with certain default value. So if it is initialized with default value, there is no need to pass this value at the time of macro call. So in what flexibility is getting here, macro, whenever macro is called at that time, this value A will get assigned to X, this B will get assigned to Y. As this keyword parameter has default value, it is initialized with certain default value, it does not require any value to be passed while calling, and this particular keyword based parameter is going to get this value. So you need to make use of this variable over here as this is keyword based parameter. So this is what is the difference. And here the thing which we need to understand, so whenever macro is called, whatever model statement, now this is the prototype, this is the name of the macro, macro CALC, this is the name of the macro, this is a list of parameters which you need to pass, and these are the model statements out of it, and this is the directive, macro and embed. So macro, wherever macro it gets the keyword or directive macro, at that time the rule of macro processor comes into picture, and it keeps whichever model statements are there in that macro in certain tables, so that whenever that macro is called, using contains in that data structure, the expansion task can be carried out. Okay, so how, which data structure it requires and how it does all that task, that we will be discussing afterwards. But for now, what we need to understand, whenever assembler gets this macro statement, it handovers the responsibility of handling it to macro processor, or you can call it as a preprocessor as well. And when it gets end, now macro preprocessor handovers the control to assembler. Likewise, so that are called as directives. That sort of actions are required with whenever it gets these two keywords. And in the task of expansion, what it does, as actual parameters passed, values for actual parameters are these. So what it does, these three are model statements in the macro definition. So these three are converted in a way so that assembler will be able to absorb it, that all that instructions are get mapped in the form of assembly instruction. Okay, so that is why that are expanded, lab is expanded by or replaced by a loop over here, and this plus is appended everywhere just to indicate that these are the expansion statements of macro for assembler, to understand the assembler, because at the end assembler is going to get this or treat this as an input for further processing. Okay, so this is how the expansion task is carried out. So wherever these variables, whatever variables are there, actual values are filled up, and all the instructions are mapped in the form of macro, assembly instructions. So this was simple program. Apart from that, there are other macro controls as well, or other keywords are also there, which are used while defining the macro, just to give some value addition or certain capability to that macro utility. So which are that? One of the example of that is expansion time variable. So it is local and global expansion variables one can declare and set its value or initialize its value by using the keyword set. We will not be going into the details exactly how the things are handled and all, because we need to solve one example as well, that how expansion task is carried out and how, which data structure it requires to make use of. Okay. So these are sample variables are there which are created using LCL statement. This is the variable created, and this is that then variable is initialized by using set with certain value, and then what exactly it is going to attend, that is written on the further slide, that this expansion, this particular statement initialize A as a 1, and then it this another thing expands, or this sets the another memory container, you can call as a suffix or a, sorry, successor to that A container with value 2 by adding contains 1 into the contents of container A likewise. So another facility which is given is attributes can be specified for formal parameters. If you want to do that, these are the three attributes which you can mention in addition, called as attributes for formal parameters. Okay, which indicates type, length and size, that additionally can be mentioned with the parameters which you want to mention over there. Okay, and these are the sort of labels. Okay, now the new thing which you can find over here is this one. Okay, so these are certain conditional expansion variables which are supported in the while defining the macro. For example, whenever this particular thing is written, this keyword is used over there, so it indicates if condition is satisfied, then you need to switch to whatever label is specified over there. Accordingly, there are two other as well. So one is AGO. So it does not checks with for any condition. It just directly jumps to the whatever label is specified in front of it. And on the similar lines, one more is also there called as ANOP, which does not perform anything, just it places void over there, okay, without checking any condition at all. Many times it is required, we cannot study the case for use of that particular keyword over there in this particular session. But this is how the conditional expansion variables are used. Then expansion time loops can be used. So expansion time loops can be used in this way by making use of just incremental increment of certain variable. Or one more facility which is provided for doing that is nothing but you can make use of repeat statement over there. So whatever statement you want to execute multiple times, that can be written under REPT, and then certain condition you need to specify that till what time it is expected to repeat it. And this indicates end of that repeat, end M. This is how the facility for iterative execution of certain things are provided in the macro. Okay, and then semantic expansion, how that can be done, that is specified in this. So in short, whichever which constructs or which are the attributes which we have learned in this session, which are important or which one must understand, is nothing but we have learned that it makes use of directive called as macro. Then it makes use of another directive called as MEND, which indicates end of macro. I have told you significance of everything. Then it makes use of certain control statements like AIF, then AGO, then ANOP, then expansion time variable. It is able to declare by making use of what? LCL, then GCL, isn't it? And apart from that, it supports repeat instruction and all. So these are the certain things which we have discussed that how that can be used. Now, the main thing which comes in is like whenever, what is the role of macro processor or preprocessor? What exactly does that? I have already explained you that this is the assembly program. It accepts the assembly program wherein macro definitions are used. So what macro, that assembly program is required to be first of all handled by macro preprocessor, as the thing is required to be preprocessed, that is what is called as preprocessor. You know? So what it does, it whatever macro definition it has, it processes it and creates that, or that model statements are kept in certain data structure it has to use, and it keeps all that information in that data structures, and then converts that program without macro definition and just into the assembly instructions without macro definition. So it performs the task of expansion and it handovers to the assembler, and then assembler converts that code into the target code, or that assembly instructions into the target code. So what are the tasks involved in macro expansion? First of all, recognize a macro call, identify where macro is called, decide what values formal parameters should have in expansion of the macro call, then maintain values of expansion time variables, organize expansion time control flow, then find the statements that define specific sequencing symbol, and then perform expansion of model statements. All right. So four-step procedure is used for that. It's nothing but first of all, identify the information needed for performing the task, design suitable data structure for recording of the information, determine the processing needed for obtaining and maintaining the information, and then determine the processing needed for performing task by task using recorded information. So how it performs that recording of information, that is shown over here. So these are certain data structures which are used for keeping the data from the macro definitions which is going to get at the time of pre-processing, and maintains in certain tables. So these are certain tables, that is macro name table, parameter name table, expansion time variable name table, then sequence symbol name table, keyword parameter table, default table, likewise tables it creates. And every table has the different column values over there. So how that are created, on what basis that gets created, that we will be discussing. For example, consider this is the macro definition given, and this is the macro call which is used in the assembly program. So whenever it is going to get this macro call, whenever it is going to get this macro definition, when it gets this particular directive, at that time it creates the entry in the MNT table, macro name table. So what is the name of the macro? This is the name of the macro, clear MEM. So it will enter it in. So which are the how many positional parameters are there? How many keyword based parameters are there? How many expansion time variables are there? MDT statement, MDT pointer is at which particular instruction number, that it needs to understand. So these are number of things, that is positional parameter, keyword based parameter, and expansion time variable. And these are the pointers or positions of the entries of that particular macro in another table. For example, here a keyword parameter table is there. So in that table, it is having the entry of that keyword parameter for this macro at 10th position, because there can be multiple macros. Na? So you cannot assume every time. If we'll assume it that no macro has occurred initially, in that case, it will be initiating it by position 0 or 1. From whatever position you would be initiating the array, it will depend on that. But it is, in that case, it is going to be 1. Okay. Similar lines for SSTP as well, it is going to be 1. Considering that this is the first macro which it has encountered. For MDTP as well, it is same. So MDTP means that wherever model statements, it is going to enter in that MDTP table. So in that, but with respect to this macro definition, at which particular sequence number the model statements are mapped, that it will be entering. For example, all the model statements are entered from 25th position. That is why it will maintain the entry as 25. And all the model statements in the form of assembly language will get mapped over here. And whenever it is going to get MN, so it indicates that expansion has to be stopped over there for substituting the model statement. So this is how the tables are created. So what is this? These are nothing but positional parameter, names of the positional parameter, sequence symbol, then expansion time variable names and all that are kept in different tables. So that is the only thing which we need to understand, that what exactly, which tables or data structure it requires to maintain and how that tables are utilized. So how that tables are utilized, that is nothing but whenever it is going to get the call for that macro definition, at that time it will just move towards this particular position, will substitute all the statements until and unless it is going to get the amend statement, and will stop it will stop the expansion task likewise. Okay, so this is what is the things which we need to understand regarding macro preprocessor. Or if you don't want the macro preprocessor to be separate utility in a logical program, in the system programming, in that case you can give this capability to assembler itself, and you can call that assembler as a macro assembler. That's it. I hope you have understood and you have enjoyed. Thank you.